to take on the bad debt, the bad assets, and then they reprivatize them when they get healthy?
Well, that's an interesting question. I think there's good reason to say don't take on the bad debts. You know, let them go into bankruptcy and then take over the assets to restructure. Hmm. Now this gets us into a huge additional problem in that in the creation of phantom wealth, and of course many of these derivatives and so forth were ultimately sold off to pension funds or to university endowments or local municipality trust funds or whatever. You begin to look at that, and what you realize is that the total financial claims that were built up through that process far exceed any real wealth of the planet, which means that they are fictitious. They can never be realized. We've been treating money as a storehouse of value. What it's really it can be a storehouse of expectations. But those of us who have, we may have comfortable retirement accounts, it's not clear how we're going to be able to redeem that, because there's not enough wealth in the society, of real wealth, of real people doing real things, to maintain us at the level of our expectations. So all of this needs to be reworked out in this process of restructuring the financial system. It's not going to be easy or comfortable.
Because when you talk about letting some of these big institutions go bankrupt, as you say, you're talking about pension funds of labor unions, government investments as well, universities.
Yes.
Everybody got involved in getting into the markets, and now everyone, to one degree or another, will pay from the unraveling of these markets.
Yeah, and part of the really insidious nature of it is the way the money managers are running the system. They're creating all of these fictitious transactions as a justification for collecting fees from the system, such as some of the highest compensated hedge fund managers were taking home more than $1 billion a year in compensation. Now, that's where we need to do some serious taxation to recover that money. That's pure theft. And what they were really doing was raiding the equity of these funds, which was supposed to be the cushion against risk. And so again, this is a form of fraud that cannot be allowed to endure.
David Corton, what does the end of empire mean?
The end of empire. This puts it all in a historical context, and it very much relates to democracy. 5,000 years ago, as a species, we moved away from more community-oriented forms of organization. We began to organize ourselves by dominator hierarchy. I refer to that period of the move to empire, and it was not just about one nation dominating another, but it was about a dominator hierarchy at all levels of society. From the relationships among nations to relationships within families, relationships between gender, between races, and so forth. Now, we have gone through some democratizing processes, but the fact is we are still in that era of empire, of organization of society by dominator hierarchy. And whereas the rulers used to be kings and emperors, they are now corporate CEOs and hedge fund managers. And the system has morphed into where the real rule in society, put aside all our elections, democracy, and so forth, the real rule has been by Wall Street institutions through the system of money as a system of power.
David Corton, author of Agenda for a New Economy, From Phantom Wealth to Real Wealth, Why Wall Street Can't Be Fixed and How to Help It. This is Democracy Now! When we come back, we look at the mother of Barack Obama. Stay with us.
Child grows up to be somebody that just loves to learn, and another child grows up to be somebody you just love to burn. Mom loves the both of them. You see, it's in the blood. both kids a good mom. Blood's thicker than the mud. It's a family affair.